spoken to the congregation, but he was talking to a congregation. See, we've got a seesaw effect here. His thoughts were that he had not quite fully attained an understanding or got a hold of the full impact of God's grace. Even as a witness to the obvious recipient of the forgiving power that has been bestowed on him, remember, on the road, Christ talked to him and said, "Why do you go against me?" Paul, if you remember, his name then was Saul. He was a Sanhedrin. It's an organization in Israel. It's still in effect today. MI5 and the American idea of spies and what have you had nothing on the Sanhedrin. They were some special kind of people. They are the ones who actually asked crucified Christ. I'll give you a letter. Okay. So, Paul couldn't quite understand the impact of his forgiveness because he didn't quite understand how he was going to get from here to heaven. He had not yet attained his goal of total forgiveness as he understood it. He still was not affected, and neither are we. Was he still hanging on to what happened in the past? Possibly. When he was known as Saul the persecutor and the prosecutor of Christmas? Quick answer to that, I don't know. That's another sermon. Am I still working on it? Christ died for us so that we may receive grace, forgiveness. There is a massive forgiveness around. All we have to do is ask for it and go to God for it. And the Christ that is will be with you and you will receive it. Because in Matthew 26:28, we are told, "For this is my blood of the new covenant, the new promise, which is shed for many, for the remission of sins." For the remission of sins. But what about us today? Here. We're in our seats. We are here. Okay. What about our sins? What about, I stepped forward some time ago and said, "I believe in Jesus. Praise Him. They dumped me, I came up wet, I went, got changed, and my sins are forgiven." Simple, easy. But what if you were to really ask, what does Christ ask of me? What does God ask of me? Who's been apprehended? Who, and for what reason? Are we arrested? Have we been apprehended? Maybe not. What stuff is ahead? Who is pressing what? And where? And by how much? And how is that going to affect me? Will that pressing hurt? What does it all mean? Up to where? And to what call? And how high? Simple questions. So what is ahead that I have to see? You know, forgetfulness of the past and the eager anticipation of the future are sometimes, we think, a child's exclusive right to take advantage of. But as adults, we still need to forget some of our past and live for our future. We are excited when we get a new job. We anticipate the act of learning a new skill. We want to press forward and grasp a hold of the whole idea of advancing oneself. And we enjoy that. Right? I think. I Mr. Jerry Duncan, the office I work, I retired. Sorry, guys. But it's over when it's cracked up for me. But what we do not understand or fail to realize is some of us are still children. We haven't grown too far. We're unable to grasp just what we have in our forgiveness. There's a different idea. We have not yet apprehended or understood our true forgiveness because we just look at one stuff, one facet, one surface. I ask you, ladies, what would your diamond ring look like with only one facet? If you want to think, bigger. It would be dull, uninteresting, no sparkle. There would be no refraction of light, no little sparkly things inside where it goes red, yellow, and blue, and purple. None of that. If you only had one facet to your diamond, you wouldn't be looking at it as being a treasure. And that is the same as your forgiveness. If you only see one side of your forgiveness, there's not anything there but a piece of rock, or a dunking in the pool, or a few words said over you. When you cut, and you polish, and you refine, you see the true evidence of salvation and forgiveness. So should our knowledge of our own forgiveness and salvation reflect from life with it? Yes, it should. Like that diamond, you should be sparkling, you should be full of life, and the inner light that has been placed inside you by the Holy Spirit. But we don't understand that light. We're just like, well, yeah, I've been forgiven, so I can do this. Then I can say, God, forgive me. No, you can't. You see, we inhibit our power. Total, big capital letters, total forgiveness. Because we only look at one facet. Because here's the $6 million line, here it is, here it comes. We fail to forgive ourselves from that sin in the past. Okay? We go through the chemical change, but we don't head up for the spiritual change. I mean, as I've gotten older, I start to creep and get kind of pain, things start to pop. You know, wake up in the morning like this. I crawl towards my favorite chair. I pick up a Bible, and the Bible study. And this chair is special. Somebody wants to throw it up for a sharp break. The arms are all worn. Never worn through. The seat is all mashed down. It's got food stains down the front. It's got four marks where the cats have done all over it. The stuffing is all pushed out. It's kind of like me. My limbs are worn out. My seat is. I got food stains down my front, and my stuffing is pushing out of the front, and it's all because of self-inflicted sin. That sin that is still present and always has been. They say, no, hang on a minute, what sin are you talking about? I'm really glad you asked. We ask our younger children, what do you want to be when you grow up? Oh, you're so wonderful. What do you want to be when you grow up? And you literally have a little prayer, and they will not respond. I want to be just like you. When children have said that to me. I remember those simple things I did in my past. That trigger word is just like you. When we hear that, we shudder and we take a step back to the fatal day and what we did. And I'm talking about the flashback. I am talking about that sin that we never forgot. It stays with us no matter what we do or how many people say, you're forgiven, you need to forget that. I'm telling you, that sin is still there inside us and we still think about it on a regular basis. Normally, there's a trigger word that's associated with it that brings you right back, bang, right there. Right in front of that sin. You say, Now, that sin we never forget, we relive it. We carry it. It's like a heavy burden over and over again. We pick it up and carry it. We pray for that child that they do not commit the same sins you did. Remember, we say to our teenagers, don't do what I do because look what happened to me. Don't be like this because you're going to end up like this. And it's hard to get across to children and younger folk what the impact is for that sin or that wrongdoing they do now in years to come. But you know what? We act pretty childlike ourselves. Did you really listen to your parents when they put the same thing on you? Don't do this because don't do as I do, do as I say. That's a favorite phrase in my house. Don't do as I do as I say. Okay, I'll get right on that. As we start, as all the things we grow older, we start acting out because we still remember what was going on when we were children, when we were teenagers, when we were young adults. We don't understand that we are still hanging on to that sin back there. So, two, forgetting. There we go. Forgetting those things which are behind us and reaching forward to those things which are ahead. Now, getting back to Saul/Paul, when he was spoken to on the road by Christ, why do you persecute me? That's a big question. Why do I persecute him? Well, because it's my job. I'm part of the Sanhedrin. I'm part of the upper court. What I say goes. But Christ sent him on a different journey. And this is a journey I'm trying to get you started. As he turned around and went upon that journey, he was forgiven for one of the greatest crimes against Jesus Christ. And yet one of the most essential crimes towards Jesus. He was given forgiveness for persecuting him, but he was also rewarded because without his persecution, Christ would not have been crucified, and we would be his dead. Clear? Clear as mud? Probably. But you know what? We cannot really be any wiser than Paul, because what Paul did, he used his head. I hear this voice, the same voice I heard screaming from the cross. And he's telling me now, what do I have to do? I have to go back. And I have to go meet a guy. And there we have the history of Paul. But with many of us, our trust in forgiveness of ourselves, this is what I'm talking about, forgiving yourself, is in a low supply. We doubt our own forgiveness, and this can lead us to tragedy. It takes a seasoning to become an adult, in other words, the hard knocks. How many times have we thought or spoken a phrase to some other folk, grow up? Sometimes they're older than we are, but we say, grow up. Come on, grab a hold of yourself. Pull yourself up by your bootstraps. Your attitude is wrong. Change yourself. We basically need to be seasoned. It is the salt and pepper, if you would, of the earth and of the world. We are seasoned. But we should aim to apprehend, understand, that we may better understand, others may not be as seasoned as you. Okay. Paul is relating things which are behind. The place those things are to be forgiven. Here it comes. Therefore, O God. Now when I turn to you, each and every one of you, and say, what is the biggest sin that you ever had in your life? Bang! That second, you are taken back right now to that thing that you did that you still have in your mind. Now remember, I said in your mind, not in your heart. You have it in your mind because you're thinking about it. When you put it, when you clean your mind and you clear and you cleave to Christ, being cleaved. Yes. What happens to your heart? The Holy Spirit enters. So this sin that you have, the sin you have recreated over and over and over again, the sin that is holding you back from really achieving the glory of God. You are holding your back from fully realizing what God has in mind for you. You think, well, what about that sin at that time? You know, when I, well, I can't tell you what it is because it's so bad, I don't want to let anybody else know about it. But you remember that time, what time? 20 years ago? 30 years ago? 40 years ago? Aren't those people? Yeah. There's something in your mind that keeps dragging you back. And it is that thing that is holding you back from realizing the full glory of Christ and of God within you. You have it within you. But this darkness, this shadow, overpowers you, not God, not Christ. It overpowers you, so you shrink back from what God would really have you do. You have an unlimited source of power if you would just forget this one thing. If God can forgive you, why can't you? Now, God created the universe, the world, and everything on it, and every creeping thing. When was the last time you put a universe together? You got something that's but this the little bit greater than you saying you are forgiven for everything in the past. What was gone is now gone and is gone forever. But you still hang on to it. You still want to hold on to it because you're afraid that that's God can't forgive me for that because I did. Yes, you can. Yes, you can. Now remember, I told you to keep your thumb in two phrases. And this is one. If we took two phrases and put them together, we get forgetting those things which are behind. Reference to Ephesians. 2 Corinthians, all things have been passed away. Behold, all things have become new. So what you end up with is forgetting these things which are behind, because the old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Look, all things are brand new to you. All things are to your blessing. All things are towards the glory of God, and we still hang on to that slurry, that thing back here. It says here, put it behind you and go forward. And when you put the two pieces together, yes, it's the same author. Yes, it's the same situation. Two different churches. So you're not on your own. You're not on your own. Every person in every church and every person that's outside of the church has the same problem. We all have this one thing in the back of our mind that we need to let go of, so that we can benefit from that glorious feeling of, oh, I don't have to worry about it anymore. Now, as a personal example, I have to do this. I've done it. And it's almost like there's an uplifting. There's almost be like, oh my God, I can stand just a little taller. I can look people in the face. I know that I have been truly. By not forgiving yourself, you are not truly forgiven. Because you don't feel like you deserve being forgiven. Now why not? When we look at Adam, he was created out of mud, dirt, and a little bit of mist and rain. But you became the most expensive piece of real estate anybody's ever had to try and purchase. You were purchased by Jesus Christ when he died for you on the cross. God himself made you. So if God made you, and Jesus Christ purchased you, you obtained the Holy Spirit, where does this jump back in? Why do you still have it? Right. Come on, you're in one of the most powerful families, the builder, the savior, and the guide. Mm-hmm. Why are you hanging on to God's joke? Mm-hmm. I know it's not easy. I know it's not simple. You really have to work. You really have to work hard at it, because if you're 40 years old, you've got 30 years of this thing hanging on your back. If you're 60 years old, you've probably got 50 years, 40 years of it hanging on your back. You just don't wipe it off. Like, okay, I've done that now, because, you know, Pastor Bay said so. I can do this now because Pastor Bay. No, it's because you can. And it takes a day or two. Don't expect it to happen overnight. You can get forgiveness of what you've done. Now, if you don't do this, I'm sorry. I'm very sorry. Because you're condemning yourself. You do this, you just take it one day at a time. Remember something, one day at a time, sweet Jesus. That wasn't exactly sung as a negative promise. One day at a time, clean yourself up. Clean yourself up what you messed up. Notice that. Okay, here we go. Verse 14. I press towards the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. I press forward, I press towards, I move towards the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Now, I don't want to sound rough, but this is, get over it, vanquish it, douse it, get rid of that consuming fire and flame. Because, as I said before, realizing and focusing on our glorious future, which we are supposed to be aiming ourselves to, because we believe in forgiveness and we have been blessed with the Holy Spirit, we will receive that before God in Christ Jesus, because we are pressing towards the goal. You know, that pressing towards the goal of the prize, it is, I don't know about you, but I kind of get a picture of that long distance runner. He set out to do 15 miles, 20 miles. He knows he has a long, long run. But he sets off. He sets his pace. And he goes. Now, a long distance runner doesn't have time to cast aside. They're catching up with me. He is running his own personal race. He's running his own with his own steps. He's moving through his own path of sin to get to the goal. He doesn't have the time to say, well, I'm going to sit here and find out who's following me. We know what's following you, that bunch of baggage. So you move forward, you keep forward. Don't think you can run 20 miles an hour. Start off with 2 or 3 miles an hour, see how it feels. Then you increase, then you get, before you know it, you are as your goal. It's like everything. You don't take an exam without studying it. You have to get into the books and understand. Get into the book.
Get into the book.
Try that one. You know? That's your directions. That's your map. That's your plan. You get into that and you think, why am I not doing this? It sounds like a great idea. It is a great idea. But as we press and we move forward, we will achieve. We will achieve that forgiveness. Now, as a runner, we have to pace ourselves. When it comes to Bible study, forgiveness, we have to pace ourselves. No good thinking you're going to get it overnight. No minister with his word is sold became a minister overnight. No bus driver became a bus driver overnight. Nobody gets anything overnight. And the same is a sorry thing to say, that people expect to be fixed overnight. And they can't be. They can't be. I mean, it's very hard when you have been in the world to wrap your head around what now dwells in your heart. First of all, what do you mean it dwells in my heart? Well, it can't dwell in your head because your head is full of filth and dirt, sin, corruption, and everything else. It has to have somewhere to grow. Your heart is pure, strong, clean. Let's face it, at the age of I don't know how long, your heart's probably beaten over a million times. You can't build a pump like that in the world. The heart is the strongest organ you have in your body. And that is where you hide your faith. You hide it back there so it can be nourished. You hide it there so it can grow. It's like a plant. You can either stick it in the dirt or you can stick it in the gravel. You stick it in the gravel, if you're off, you'll die because there's not enough nourishment there. You put the plant in the dirt and it will grow because it flourishes. You know, when you put a fruit tree down, the fruit tree says to itself, that's stretching it a bit. If the fruit tree says to itself, I am going to bear fruit, and it bears fruit. Why can't we as human beings, as God's created being, understand that when we are nurtured, we will bear fruit? When we are able to forgive ourselves for that and concentrate on our run ahead of us, we will bear fruit. We will grow. We will become a spiritual dynamo. we will have the strength of God in us, beside us, and leading the way for us to go. But we don't. But we are still waiting for those memories of the past of sin to pursue us, to drag us back. But let me just say this. On that run, you really cannot look back when you start on this course. You really cannot look back and see where you've been. You've got to stay focused on the front. Because when you're running this race and you look back, you fall on your face. And then you have to pick yourself up and start all over again. So too. So, maintain yourself, remembering only those things which are wholesome, meaningful, full of grace, love, care, and when that nasty piece starts coming through, you get rid of it. You say, no, I refuse. I'm not going to go back there anymore. I don't want to do that. I want to do forward. I'm not going to go back there. Verse 14. Press forward, the goal of the prize, the upward pull of the life of Christ. I will not keep you long. This is my last verse. Christianity should be and could be the perfection of common sense. Say it again. Christianity could be perfection of common sense. When you use your common sense and within your Christian boundaries, you become a fulfilled Christian. By constant practice, you refine and define your plan and your life, your route. People know well enough that they cannot be good carpenters or doctors or fiddlers without certain habits and practices. Look at the doctor. You go to a doctor's office and he says, this is my practice. He's still practicing his skills as a physician. As I said, we are on a long journey. How can you become a fulfilled Christian without practice to give them for yourself? Really, that's a tough question. How can you become a fulfilled Christian without practicing forgiveness of yourself? Become. You go through the motions, but you are self-condemning yourself. You are self-restraining from the total glory and forgiveness of God. God that you should know and be conscious of throughout your forgiveness